Now, new developments in the upcoming battle for control of the Senate. Montana Democrat Max Baucus surprised Capitol Hill today by announcing he will not seek re-election when his term ends next year. That makes him the 8th senator and the 6th Democrat to step aside. The 2 Republicans hold safe red seats in Nebraska and Georgia, and 3 of the Democrats are from states President Obama carried last fall. But the rest are toss-ups that may cost Democrats control of the Senate in 2014. Plus, 4 more incumbent Democrats from North Carolina, Arkansas, Louisiana, and Alaska are considered vulnerable. So can one senator's decision change the political landscape? For that, we turn to Stuart Rothenberg of the Rothenberg Political Report and Amy Walter of the Cook Political Report. Good to have you both here. What's the answer to the question, Stu?
Yeah, I think it changes the math a little bit. You know, there are 4 seats right off the top that Republicans are very optimistic about. 2 opens, South Dakota and West Virginia, and then the 2 Democratic senators from the South, Mary Landrieu of Louisiana and Mark Pryor of Arkansas. Getting beyond that 4 is the challenge. It's not to say the Republicans will win any or all of those, but they have a pretty good chance. So the question is, can they broaden the playing field? Montana is an important addition. They need to put these other seats, as you mentioned, Alaska, North Carolina, into play.
And Max Baucus is no backbencher.
No, he's, you know, the chairman of a very, very important the finance committee, and he's been around for 30 years. I mean, that's what you're seeing with so many of these folks who are retiring. They've been committee chairman, they've been in Congress for 30 or more years. Actually, the interesting thing about open seats is no party really wants to have an open seat, right? They usually are tougher to defend. But in the case of Montana, it actually may be a better situation for Democrats. If Democrats are able to get the candidate that they're all talking about right now, Brian Schweitzer, the former governor of that state, left office, very popular. He is the quintessential Montana Democrat.
And right? Are they going after him?
Oh, they most certainly will be going after him. If Schweitzer's in that position, he runs as a governor, not as a 30-year incumbent with a long voting record, especially on some more controversial votes like the health care legislation.
Not as a Washington figure, exactly. But as a good old boy. He's very charismatic and very Montana.
He knows how to rock a bolo tie.
He does know how to rock a bolo tie.
But let's talk about other retirements. In a more general sense, what else is tipping or could be tipping the balance this time?
Well, I think there are individual reasons. For some of them, it's health. Jay Rockefeller is age and health. Tim Johnson, obviously, health. I think for Mike Johanns, the Republican from Nebraska, a younger man in his early 60s, I'm not sure the Senate was an ideal fit for Johanns. But for a lot of these, as Amy pointed out, a lot of these members are very senior. 5 of the 8 are over 70. 5 of the 8 have served 5 terms or more. So, you know, there are cycles in American politics, and the Democrats are hitting retirements in a particularly difficult class at a not an ideal time for them.
And that's what politics is all about, timing. And
right.
Republicans are hoping that the 3rd time is the charm here. 2010, 2012. Stu and I would have come in here and said, boy, the map looks really bad for Democrats. They could lose control of the Senate. And then those years unfolded. And, of course, 2010 was the year of the Tea Party, but it was also the year where Republicans nominated terrible candidates in states they were supposed to win. 2012, we, of course, had the infamous Todd Akin in Missouri and Richard Murdoch in Indiana. So there were 5 seats, essentially, that Republicans lost because they just simply had terrible candidates.
But are there any open any Republican seats being vacated where Republicans are at a disadvantage?
Not at a disadvantage. I suppose, I mean, there is a scenario for Democrats to compete in Georgia. Very crowded Republican field. If one of the less broadly acceptable Republicans, like Congressman Paul Brown, for example, were to be the nominee, I think Democrats would think we have an opportunity. They are recruiting candidates. They're recruiting either Congressman Barrow of Georgia, Democrat, has proven to be a very strong candidate as a member of the House. And I believe they're recruiting Sam Nunn's daughter as a possible candidate. So Democrats are trying to put a good candidate in play in Georgia should the Republicans self-destruct.
So Democrats are hoping that they get another revisitation of the luck they had last time, which is the Republicans
exactly.
Shoot themselves in the foot.
Even in states where they're on defense. I mean, Democrats are definitely playing defense this year. They got to play a little offense in 2012. They're not so lucky this year. 2016 looks great for them if they want to wait that long. But they have to hope that in a place like Alaska, for example, there could be a competitive primary where the quote-unquote wrong candidate comes out so that you get a situation like 2010 where the weaker candidate wins a Republican primary, giving a Democrat a chance to hold a tough seat.
If you are a second-term president about to enter the lagging days of your power, and you are losing people in your party in the Senate, what do you do about that? How does the president begin to position himself so that he's not at a complete disadvantage as he has all these big legacy-making domestic issues lining up?
Well, he has to, on the one hand, there's not much that he can do about any of these. Trying to keep some of them there was not going to be an issue. But for so many of these red state Democrats, this is a great irony. Whether they're running as incumbent or whether this for an open seat, they're going to spend their entire campaign running away from the president. So actually, you know what they'd like from him is to not talk to them or to not make their lives that much harder. Certainly the gun vote was one of those votes that many of them did not want to have to take. And they're hoping there aren't going to be that many more on the docket.
Is this just midterm politics as normal as usual, or is this an unusually high level of defections?
Well, we have had a number of retirements on past few cycles, and so this isn't that much out of the ordinary. I mean, my initial reaction was it was, and then I went back and looked, and it isn't. But it's still important, and this gets right to, I think, the heart of your point. How the outlook for the Senate in 2014 starts to really kick in terms of legislative politics in the Senate at the end of this year and then certainly next year. Because if the Republicans think we're going to pick up 4, 5, maybe 6 Senate seats, we just have to hang in there, hang tough, not give the president any victories, and then he's going to have to deal with us after the Senate. That is going to change the dynamic. And to the extent to which Republicans are at all cooperative, if 4 or 5 months from now, 6 months from now, they figure we're in a position, we're going to gain seats. They're going to be less cooperative.
On the other hand, isn't there something good to be said about fresh blood? We keep saying people stay in Washington too long, that this is a chance to mix things up.
Well, so we've been saying that for a while, and there's always been talk about term limits being good to flush things out. If you look at the Senate in 2015, at least 49 members of the Senate will have been elected since 2008. If you look in the House, 40% of the House has been elected since 2010. There has been an incredible amount of turnover, and what it has done is actually polarized the Congress more rather than bringing it together.
Oh, joy. Mm. Amy Walter of the Cook Political Report, Stu Rothenberg of the Rothenberg Political Report. Thank you both very much.
Thanks.